Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Presentation Advantage, How to Inform and Persuade Any Audience by Kory Kogon, Breck, England, and Julie Schmidt. This book is narrated by Marguerite, Gavin, and Sean Pratt. Introduction. Time, 2:30 in the afternoon on a Tuesday. Place, conference room, headquarters of Fissile Company, an online retailer of ski equipment. Event, staff meeting. Peter, a guy from finance, is giving a presentation to the dozen young executives who run the company. Let's tune in to what he's saying and what his audience is thinking. Peter, the finance guy.
I think this is a good time to go over some issues about credit card security. I have just a few slides.
Claire, the CEO, thinking to herself,
credit cards, I think mine is expiring next month. I suppose they'll send me a new one. Hope it doesn't get lost in the mail like the last time I moved. Really liked that apartment. Too bad I didn't hold on to it. Wonder how much I could have made by subletting it. Where's that calculator app?
Peter. Enhanced authorization includes data on internet protocol, and this is where our EBITDA is significantly impacted.
Max, head of sales, thinking to himself.
Enhanced. That's what Arliss wants. She wants an enhanced lifestyle. That means spending a load on plastic surgery, even though she's just fine the way she is, as I keep telling her.
Neva, company lawyer, thumbing a text quietly under the table.
So the complaint went to court this morning. I'm about halfway through the pleading, respecting the motion for a preliminary injunction.
Tad, the product director, thinking to himself.
That is one ugly slide. I have absolutely no idea what all those numbers mean. Guess he'll explain them if they're important. Hey, he just said EBITDA. Claire used that word in the meeting yesterday. It's a number. That's all I know. I wonder what it means. No way I'm going to ask.
Kip, the fulfillment manager.
Ring. Sorry, that's my phone. I've got to take this.
He's out the door.
Peter. The additional data enriches our authorization decisions.
Amita, marketing person, thinking to herself.
Isn't this meeting over yet? Here I am, right in the middle of a campaign. The designers are making one mess after another, and with the holidays coming up...
Neville, the IT manager.
Buzz. He looks at his phone. He thinks, a text from Dexter. Probably another stupid video. He's too funny. The last one was him and his dog. Yeah, it's another video.
What? He's followed his mother-in-law into a casino?
This is gonna be hilarious. I'll just mute this.
Ellie, the intern, thinking to herself.
I've got to stay awake. 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 I wonder if it's possible to sleep with your eyes open.
Peter. And when we prioritize our IT upgrade decisions, we ought to give top priority to enhanced authorization data.
Quentin, another finance guy, thinking to himself.
If we calculate the present value of the tax shield and the distress cost from the enterprise value, we could come up with a purely operating multiple totally independent of our capital structure that would outweigh the cost of potential errors if left in place.
Peter. So this is why we have to address our credit card security.
Claire. Oh, I think he's finished. I wonder what that was all about.
Well, okay, thanks, Peter. Does anyone have any questions?
No?
Okay, then. I guess we can all get back to work now.
Our shrinking attention spans.
How many presentations like this have you sat through? Why are most presentations and the audience reactions to them just like what you heard here? In today's world of technology, the minute your audience is bored or confused, they can easily disappear into their smartphones or tablets to stay occupied.
This means that when you're presenting, your audience is not at all captive. They are bombarded on all sides by people or things demanding to be noticed. They are constantly getting buzzed at, beeped at, blinked at, and distracted in every manner. It's becoming so commonplace that this is how the Urban Dictionary defines a presentation. Presentation: a set number of agonizing minutes of exclusive, divided attention, divided among you and your lousy slides, Facebook, YouTube, email, MySpace, text messages, chats, and other cool websites and iPhone apps. Intended for explaining to a group of unwilling people what took you 3 weeks to partially understand and one night to put on PowerPoint. People's attention is now the scarcest commodity there is, which is ironic when half our time is spent communicating. As City University of New York, CUNY, Professor Kathy Davidson points out, "We think we listen to what people are saying, but it turns out we're a little like dogs and that we sometimes hear the tone of voice and don't even pay attention to what the voice is actually saying." Our attention spans and emotional connections are under attack. The ease of communication has made the whole world part of our circle of contacts, but this convenience has its downside. Writer Jonathan Safran Foer told a group of college graduates, "Each step forward in technological communication has made things more convenient, but each step has also made it easier, just a little bit easier, to avoid the emotional work of being present. To write LOL rather than to actually laugh out loud, to send a crying emoji rather than actually crying, to convey information rather than humanity. It's never been easier to say nothing." How do you get a message across and persuade people to action, real action, in a world like that? We wrote this book to answer that question. We are all presenters. If you've ever been in a room like the one in Peter's speech scenario, and who hasn't, you know that Peter was not connecting with his coworkers. Their minds and hearts were somewhere else. Peter had a vitally important message to share, but virtually no one got it. It was just one more meeting with no good result. And just like Peter, all of us are constantly making lousy presentations to each other over and over. Yes, we are. "Not me," you say. "I don't give that many presentations." Lots of people say they don't present much, but they really do, more than they think. Here's the actual definition of a presentation: the sharing of information between two or more people with the intent to inform or persuade. We usually think of a presentation as a formal thing. You stand up in front of a room full of people, you speak, maybe you show slides, you answer questions, and then you sit down. It's something you deliver. People do this many different ways, formally around a table or virtually around the globe. But more often in today's world, presentations are a lot less formal, like when you sit down for a quick status report, you're on the phone with a client, you're trying to make a point to your brother-in-law, or you're asking your boss for a raise. In all these cases, you have a message to convey. You are sharing information with the intent to inform or persuade. You are making a presentation. In the industrial age, people worked with their hands. But today we live in an era of knowledge work. We work with our brains, with words and with pictures, and we spend at least half our time communicating with each other. This is how we create value in the knowledge age. Ironically, as we all know, we're just not very good at it. When we ask people why presentations fail, they always say the same things: lack of preparation, poor visuals, bad tools, over-reliance on PowerPoint, reading the slides, disengaged delivery, lack of understanding of audience needs, and no clear message. Sound familiar? People just expect they're going to hear and see poor presentations. What are poor presentations costing us? We're losing time. Think of all the prep time and audience time that's wasted. Ever been to an unproductive meeting due to a poor presentation? The lost time means lost money. But even more important, what great idea or innovation or sales opportunity never happens because people cannot communicate in a coherent and well-structured way? It stands to reason that people who can communicate will automatically have a competitive advantage. The presentation advantage. The ability to give a persuasive presentation has been called the top business skill of our age, and organizations that are highly effective at communication are more than twice as likely to significantly outperform their peers. Obviously, there is such a thing as the presentation advantage. How do you get your presentation to stand out in the middle of a constant stream of bad presentations? How do you create that sudden, sustained bond with people who would rather do almost anything than listen to another presentation? And how do you gain the presentation advantage? When you're presenting, you want a very specific outcome. You have a goal or purpose in mind, and obviously, you've connected if you achieve your goal. A story by Stephen R. Covey demonstrates this. He writes in his book titled The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People of an acquaintance of his who was frustrated about his boss's unproductive leadership style. "I've talked to him about it. He's aware of it, but he does nothing," he told me. "Well, why don't you make an effective presentation?" I asked. "I did," was the reply. "How do you define effective? Who do they send back to school when the salesman doesn't sell? The buyer? Effective means it works." An effective presentation starts with you. You are your message. If you know how to connect, that is, you have passion around the content you're conveying, you are seen as someone with character and competence, and your audience is engaged with you no matter how tough the subject, then you've got what it takes to be a great communicator. In this book, we're going back to school for a while to figure out how to make an effective presentation, to learn what goes into a presentation that works, that creates a purposeful shift in knowledge or behavior. And in today's world, that could mean with just one other person or 100 people, whether you're standing, sitting, or virtually present around the world. We're going to look not only at how to connect with your message, your audience, and yourself, but also how to develop a powerful message, design impactful visuals, and deliver with excellence.
Chapter 1. The Foundation. It's all about connecting. When you're presenting, what is your ultimate objective? Would you believe that at the core, you have the same purpose no matter the topic of your presentation? It's true. The purpose of a presentation is to shift a paradigm. Stephen R. Covey explained in The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People how the word paradigm originated from the Greek. It was originally a scientific term, and it is more commonly used today to mean a model, theory, perception, assumption, or frame of reference. In the more general sense, it's the way we see the world, not in terms of our visual sense of sight, but in terms of perceiving, understanding, and interpreting. At FranklinCovey, we talk a lot about paradigms and shifting them, and the reason we do is because getting someone to see things differently, to have a paradigm shift, is essential for change to happen. Our paradigms control our behavior. If we have the paradigm that old movies are best, we'll avoid new ones. If we have the paradigm that executives speak double talk, we won't believe what they tell us. If we have the paradigm that presentations on finance are boring, we'll sleep through them. You can tell people wearing black lenses that the world isn't utterly dark, but simply telling them won't change their paradigm. They might even believe what you say, but their paradigm won't shift, and their behavior won't change until somehow you get them to take off the black glasses and see things differently. Without a paradigm shift, they will go on walking slowly in circles and bumping into things. In simple terms, your job as a presenter is to help people change the way they look at things, and thus their attitudes or behaviors. If you don't do that, your presentation isn't effective. First, though, you need to shift your own paradigm around what it takes to create and deliver effective presentations. You must deeply believe that you must connect in three ways. Connect with your message, connect with yourself, connect with your audience. Most books on presentation skills will give you lots of tips on how to stand and deliver, how to control your voice, your posture, your mannerisms, and so forth. And you'll get that here too. But what you won't get from the other books is the real secret of making an effective presentation, connecting with your message, with yourself, and with your audience. If you can do these things, you can gain what we call the presentation advantage. You have not only the professional skills, but also the trustworthy character of a presenter to whom people will really listen. It's one thing to be a slick presenter. It's another thing entirely to be a trusted advisor to people who count on you. Our promise, if you make the mental connections we're talking about here and practice the skills in this book, you'll make effective presentations every time. Connect with your message. What does it mean to connect with your message? It means that you're driven by purpose and passion, that you care about what you're presenting. What happens if you aren't connected to your message? You're bored, you're dull, and the audience feels no impact. Passion and motivation mean everything in a presentation. The more connected you are to your message, the higher the probability of success. But you say, I'm not passionate about this thing I have to present. I really can't get excited about this topic. What you need to do is something poker players are familiar with: raise the ante. Raise the ante. The word ante means before. And in poker, the ante is the money you have to throw into the pot up front just to get the right to play the game. By raising the ante in your presentation, we mean that you increase the stakes for the audience. Ask yourself, what mission-critical strategic goal am I serving with this presentation? You make it clear that your message does matter, and you let your audience know what is at risk if they don't act. Raising the ante is a powerful way to connect with your audience. It clearly shows them what is at stake if they do not act. This chart shows two possibilities. What happens when Peter, our finance guy, fails to connect, and what happens when he raises the ante? See the difference? You see, Peter knows that Fissal Company is bleeding money because of credit card fraud, and he has a duty to make that reality as clear as possible to his coworkers. He needs to raise the ante. The same is true for you. If you always give a presentation that is strategically important, people will listen to you. You'll be the one running up the highway to tell oncoming traffic that the bridge is out. In other words, you'll be the one who's always worth listening to, and you'll have the presentation advantage. What we're saying is, connect to audience with the real message. Ask yourself what's at stake if the paradigm doesn't shift and people go on without hearing you. What will happen to them? What will happen to your organization? If you start a strategic presentation as if it's a tactical issue, you're doing your audience no favor. You don't start with, hey, this would be a good time to talk about road conditions ahead, if you're trying to tell people that the bridge is out. But I don't have strategic presentations, you say. Or maybe you're thinking, strategy? That's way above my pay grade. Every organization has, or should have, dreams, strategies, and goals. And your job is to help make those happen. Always frame your presentation in terms of those strategic issues. Never downplay the power of your real message. Why didn't Peter connect in the first place? Because he mistook a strategic issue for a tactical one. His message was not really about enhancing authorization data, whatever that is. It was about keeping thieves from stealing millions from the company's bottom line. But that message never got through. It didn't connect. Never give a presentation that isn't strategic. For example, if you're asking for a raise, you're not simply asking for more money. You're describing the value you bring to the company and how you will continue to contribute. If your message is merely tactical, Find some other way than getting up on a stage to pass the information to people who can use it. But if the game is important, if the stakes are strategic, if your message really does matter, let your energy show. You are deeply invested in it. You have vital information that decision makers need. You have a meaningful presentation to give that will have a positive impact on others. Tell it like it is. Say what's really at stake. Give it to your listeners so clearly that they would have to be doorknobs to miss it. To connect with your message, raise the ante, connect your message to things that matter, the organization's mission and goals. Get to the point. Tell people the truth they need to hear. Distinguish a tactical message from a strategic message. Don't give tactical presentations. Find some other way to pass on the information. Do give strategic presentations. It's your job. Connect with yourself. What does it mean to connect with yourself? It means that you are at one with yourself. You tell the truth. You don't have a hidden agenda or two faces. You know what you're talking about. Or you admit it if you don't. We can trust what you say. Your credibility depends on two things, your character and your competence. In the words of Stephen M. R. Covey, character includes your integrity, your motive, your intent with people. Competence includes your capabilities, your skills, your track record. And both are vital. You might think a person is sincere, even honest, but you won't trust that person fully if he or she doesn't get results. And the opposite is true. A person might have great skills and talents, but if he or she is not honest, you're not going to trust that person either. To connect with yourself, you must have a trustworthy character. You must also be competent in your subject and in your presentation skills. What happens if you aren't connected with yourself? You come across as untrustworthy, unbelievable, possibly incompetent, and as a person who may not have the best intentions. You become incredible, which is not a compliment. But your effect on others is really only a secondary issue. To be connected with yourself means you are credible to yourself. Your credibility comes from the inside out. You trust yourself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.